And I am so proud and so honored to be celebrating this beautiful holiday at the White House with all of you. I want to thank you for everything that you do for our communities and for this country, and I wish you all and all your loved ones a happy Diwali and Saal Mubarak. And with that, we will now light the White House dia.
How y'all doing? Y'all must be getting ready for a Diwali, right? Diwali is just around the corner, actually. October 19th, around the world, the Indians, especially the Hindus, will be celebrating Diwali, right? And when I say Diwali, the Diwali is actually pronounced in a different way and a different spellings. In North India, predominantly they call them a Diwali. In South India, they call them Deepavali. And actually the people who actually follow the Periyar principles and like, you know, Tamil Chavanist people, they will call them as a Deepavali. But at any rate, this is all a Diwali. But when I say Diwali, it's always there is a problem in India, anything related with the Hindu festivals. Don't get me wrong, I'm not, you know, the religious fanatic who is talking about Hinduism. Why I'm saying this all this because recently, just like days ago, Supreme Court of India said there is a big pollution in India, particularly in Delhi. Therefore, they banned selling the firecrackers in Delhi and NCR area. So my question here is, why you have to ban firecrackers if it's a pollution, right? They're calling it as a pollution. But why this always comes with pollution or any hindrance for celebrating a Hindu festival? Interestingly, India's the major religion or the predominantly the most population belong to Hinduism. But their rights always cut by these courts. In generally, we all know the legislators, they will make the law and court will implement them, or they will debate and they will tell the nuance of that law, right? But nowadays, it's become a totally different ball game in India. It's a judicial activism on everything. And the courts making their own laws and banning the stuff. Let alone people telling you can't eat the beef and the slaughter ban and all that. That's a different story. I'm not going there now. But let's see, what is Deepavali? Okay, let me say Diwali, right? In Diwali, if you say, it is actually in a different part of India, celebrates for the different reason. You must be wondering, right? But that is the truth. Because in North India, particularly the Uttar Pradesh and all these places, they celebrate Diwali as the Mahabharata story, which is actually the one section of Uttar Pradesh celebrates the Pandavas. After 12 years, they banished in the forest, they came back. And that is the celebration day for them. On the day when they came, they call them as a Diwali. But if you go to Mathura and other areas where people are fond of Krishna, they celebrate this is a Krishna's some kind of a reunion, therefore they celebrate. But when you come to South India, that's a totally different ball game. Here, this is not a Ravana story or a Rama story, because in North India, majority of them, they celebrate Rama after killing the Dravidian king. Oh no, I'm not going there. Dravidian king, right? Yeah, that is a different story. Aryan and Dravidian race, that we have a different problem for that too. I'll come to that. But what happens here is that Rama goes and bring back his wife Sita, and after this 14 years of all this drama in Ramayanam, he comes back to Ayodhya, where he takes back his kingdom from his brother Bharat. So that day they celebrate, this is as the homecoming for Rama. So the North India, they celebrate Rama's arrival. So what happens in when I said this a Dravidian and Aryan drama in a South India, what we believe is that Ravana, the man whom they call him as a demon king, who actually ruled Lankapuri or today modern day Sri Lanka, and he's a Dravidian king, according to us. And according to us, Rama is an Aryan king because he came from Mount Caucasus and the Caucasians people, and you know, the Aryan race. And Rama, if you look at him, he's a white guy, and Ravana will be looking like me, black guy. Okay, so that's the story. So what happens here is, the Rama was banished by his own father for 14 years to forest. He goes to the forest, and his wonderful brother Lakshmana follows him, and Rama's wife Sita also was going with him. So they were all living in, there is a forest called Dandakaranya. And that time, Sita and her brother-in-law Lakshmana, both of them were sitting and chatting, and all of a sudden, Sita looks around that side, there is a beautiful golden deer called Marison. We all know there is no golden deer, right? But who knows, this was a mythological period, or this is an ancient kingdom, probably there is a golden deer, must have been alive and must be roaming around. And Sita looks at the golden deer and she says, hey, brother-in-law Lakshmana, do you see that beautiful deer? I want that. And he looks at that and he says, dear sister-in-law, I don't know this is real. I don't know why you want this. And she gets annoyed. She thinks this man doesn't want to go there. He wants to chatting with her and move something wrong, right? The women always, they think they are very protective of themselves. So she thinks this man is trying to do something when his older brother is not here. But as a matter of fact, Lakshmana is not the kind of a bad guy. And there is a big argument between them. And finally, Lakshmana says, it's all right, sister-in-law. I obey you, you are like my mother, so you ordered me, you want me to go and capture that golden deer. Yes, I will capture that and I come. But you have to promise me that you're not going to get out of this house and you have to stay whatever is happening. Then what he does, Lakshmana takes his arrow and makes a big line in front of that house. He says, do not cross this line and just stay there. Why I'm saying this, because there is a group of Indians. Oh, by the way, this entire Supreme Court case actually filed not by the non-Hindus. This is actually filed by the Hindus who claim they are environmentalists. I'm not against environmental. I'm not against the, you know, the pollution control. I am all for it. I am for a climate protection. I believe in a climate change, but certain things we got to follow our custom. This is just one day you going to burst the crackers, therefore, and this is going to pollute the entire planet? I don't think so. So why I'm saying this, particularly because there's a so-called moderate Hindus, what they actually in the social media and in a court, they argue the fireworks, it's not Indian, historically or traditionally, this is not a Hindu's practice. And they're claiming this is because the Chinese, the one who first invented the gunpowder, you know, the sulfate. But that is in the modern history, what we know, the modern military history we know, they introduced the gunpowder and the battle, and that's all true. That was in the 7th century. But look at this Ramayanam or Mahabharatam. Both of them were just before the Christ. I mean, thousands of years before Christ even was born, or even the Christianity was even invented, right? So this was the time. Why I'm saying this, because if Hindus, or whatever you call those people where they lived on those days, they knew exactly what is the firepower is. What I'm trying to tell you now, you will listen to this story very carefully. So now, Lakshmana says, okay, Sita, and you just stay behind this line, do not cross this line. So this line will protect, because he assumed something is going to happen wrong, right? So he walks out and he runs towards the Marison, the golden deer. And as soon as he sees Lakshmana, That deer runs, and now he's chasing him. Who let that dog? Whoop, whoop, whoop. Like that, they were running, both of them. He's chasing and he's going there. He takes his arrow and aiming. Now, cut. Go back to Sita's abode, right? Now, the Sita, why this is all happening here? Because the Ravana, our Dravidian king, actually fall in a kind of a love with this beautiful white girl. You know, the Aryans are, they are predominantly the white people, and they have a blue eyes and they have a beautiful broad forehead and all that stuff, and she's really beautiful. So that what I'm trying to say is she is that beautiful. Okay, so now Sita was standing inside our house and whatever she's doing there, and all of a sudden she hears a sound, Amma! Someone was begging outside our house. This is actually the king Ravana. In those days, those people are like a Star Trek people, so they can fly anywhere, they can come around, and they can disguise themselves in a different form. You know, they had all kind of magical stuffs in those days itself, what we are seeing in a Star Trek. Okay, today, but it's always existed in those days. So now, Sita, she hears somebody was begging, therefore she comes outside, and she looks at him. There was a beggar, says, I'm very hungry, Ma, can you provide me some food? Sita says, okay, just stay there, I'll bring you. She walks inside, but Ravana is a cunning fellow. He didn't come here to beg her food, right? He want to kidnap her. So Ravana takes this one step, and immediately there is that entire line become a kind of a firewall. So now you see the fire comes out of that line, and he couldn't get into sight, right? So Ravana was standing. So this is not something was written yesterday or 100 years ago. This was written in Valmiki Ramayana, even before the Christ, thousands of years ago. So when I was studying, I mean, this is not just a joke. Japanese were doing this. This is called the Lashmana Rega or Lashmana line. And the Japanese wanted to do a research on this. This is actually, I was told while I was studying in defense and strategic studies in the 90s, my professor, Dr. Casey, who is actually an atheist, okay, he does not believe in God. And he told us, and he brought us the paper documents, and he thrown our face, and he said, look at this. Maybe Ramayana and Mahabharatana is kind of epics and mythological story, but there is a defense strategy and a weapon power and a firepower all there. That is what we have to learn. That's what our professor told us. And we found there is documented evidence where Japanese were doing research on Lakshmana land. So if they could able to find this Lakshmana line, so you don't need to have a big fence like what President Trump want to build between the United States and Mexico, right? You can just put this Lakshmana line and no Mexican can cross this side or no American can cross other side, okay? So this is, that's a firepower right there. So now, all of a sudden, and now we'll cut back to Marison, we'll go back to that story, and he aims, and he shoots the arrow, and attacks the golden deer. And golden deer, while he was dying, he screams, Sita. When he cried Sita, that sounded like Rama was calling Sita for in a kind of some distress situation. So Sita was fooled by Ravana and the Marison gang. So Sita can cross because the line was belonged to her family. So she might know the password or whatever it is, but maybe the Lakshmana would have spelled it like only Sita can cross, nobody else can cross, right? So Sita crosses and Ravana was kidnapped. Then that's the Ramayana story. So once after this, Rama comes back, then there's a lot of story behind this. And Hanuman, there's a monkey god and all, they go back and to Sri Lanka. They fight, they kill Ravana, they bring back Sita to Ayodhya, where he was finally to go back, right? So that is a day they celebrate as the Diwali, right? But when we come to South India, particularly in Tamil Nadu and Kerala and Andhra Pradesh, we celebrate, this is a Naragasuran Vadam. There was a demon called Naragasuran. He was killed by, He was getting a lot of problem for the people in those days. So Lord Krishna goes and kills him. So when he killed them, people were started to celebrate. And that day, they said, the dark is gone, so now we have a light. So they put the rose of a light. That's what's a Deepavali. Or Deepavali, that's what we do in South India. But the fireworks, there is a lot of documented evidence are there. Fireworks or firepower is not new to India. It was in a sculpture. Even if we go back to Arthashastram, which was written probably like 2300 years ago, and even in that, they call them as Agnishurana. Agnishurana is nothing but a sulfate and a phosphate mixture. When you mix them, how it makes a fire or a smoke, they used it for warfare. So in Arthashastra is there. So you can go back to any public library in America. You can look for Chanakya or Kaudilyan and written this a book called Arthashastram. It comes in a big bound volume. One side has a Sanskrit and it has this English translation. That's where you can get that book in any public library in America. We studied in defense and strategic studies. So my point here is, whether it's a Deepavali or a Deepavali or it's a Naragasuran. Oh, by the way, even the Sikhs in India, you know, you see them turban people in this country with a long bear, and they've been mistaken as a Taliban and they've been killed here after the 9/11, and even sometime the racial drama happens in this country, they get killed. So they think they are a Taliban, but they are not. They are good people, Sikh people. They also celebrate this Deepavali on the same day. That's the day they actually, in Jahangir's, the King Jahangir prison, Guru Gobind Singh actually escapes. So they celebrate his homecoming as their Deepavali. So they make firecrackers and they bust the firecrackers, they light and they enjoy their life, right? Likewise, the Jains who believe in the Mahavirs, right? Those people actually believe in Mahavir and they celebrate on the same day on October 19th as a Deepavali and putting the lights and all that stuff. And likewise, if you look at the Buddhist in Nepal, they celebrate too. They think it's Lakshmi's marriage and it is goddess of Lakshmi and a Buddha Purnima and all that is comes together and they do that too. So predominantly this is right. And even if you go to Malaysia actually they have on a Deepavali day, it is called an open house. You can go to the prime minister's house and a king's house, they call Sultan, or anybody's house, like Hindus goes to the Muslim's house, Muslims comes to the Hindu's house, and this is called the open house. I've been there for several times in Deepavali times. So you go to everybody's house and the Muslims goes to Hindu's house, and this all house were kept open. They give you a lot of sweets and goodies and people they enjoy, and they have a big fireworks. As a matter of fact, Indonesia is the world's largest Muslim population country, right? They just declared 18th and 19th is a national holiday for Hindu festival Diwali in Indonesia. I don't know how many Hindus lives there. We all know the Sumatra, Java, you know, those areas, a lot of Hindus and Buddhist lives. But they do celebrate. And why we go all the way? In America, we celebrate, you know, White House Diwali. And I'm sure this year, President Trump also going to light the lamp, I was told, all right? So this is everywhere, but only unfortunately in India, everything becomes a problem for Hindus particularly. I mean, when you say the Rama, the name itself is a problem, because you all know there is a Ram temple, you know, the birthers movement in India is not only in America. Obama was whether born in America or in Kenya, right? That has become election debate. In India, they claim Rama was born in the place called Ayodhya, where that's the Ramayanam story exists today. And some section of the Muslim says, no, that is belong to Babur Mosque. True, because the Babur came there, Babur did not come before Rama was born in this country, right? Babur came only in the 1500s, right? So when he came, he destroyed the existing Ram temple and he built the Babur Mosque. And I'm not saying that erasing that Babur Mosque is right or wrong. You know, there's some extreme Hindus, they went and destroyed the Babri Mosque, and that dispute still is going on. So now that is a dispute, and now this comes from the pollution control, so they don't want you to use the firecrackers. When you put this kind of a ban, actually, people will do it more. That is my humble submission. You know, I just want to ask the one question. This is same Supreme Court of India. Can they go and tell, hey, Christians, you cannot cut the trees for celebrate Christmas. Hey, Muslims, you can slaughter the animals for celebrating a Bakrid. Oh, by the way, what about a noise pollution? 5 o'clock in the morning, right? 5 o'clock in the morning, almost all over India, you can hear Allahu Akbar. That's called Azaan. I really love Azaan because when I was young and growing up, probably 6 to 7 years old in back in India, and we had our family doctor called Dr. Abdul Razak, wonderful man. And he's a MD and he's a family doctor, but this doctor every day morning, 4:45, he will be sitting in the mosque and he will be prayer calling, Azaan. We are, my mothers will wake us up, hey, it's 5 o'clock, get up, you all have to study. You know, that is how we enjoy this Azaan. I'm not saying the Azaan should be banned. If a Supreme Court of India thinks it's a pollution, that's a noise pollution. Can you cut it off? No, you can't. This is always against the majority people who has no voice in that country. That is my take on the fireworks. I mean, the fireworks, even this country, we may make fireworks on July 4th. As a matter of fact, October 19th, you all come to my home, we will be cracking the fireworks. There will be big fireworks will be happening in my house, and people in the neighborhood will come, we all enjoy. As a matter of fact, the weekend, we will be going to the temple. In the temple, the community gathers together and we all together bust. So basically, this is all kind of a community event. I don't know why the politics comes into people's enjoyment. I never understand all this stuff. So as a matter of fact, when you were young, you know, mom's at home, you know, she will make a list. Okay, 700 rupees for a dress. You know, we all have to wear a new dresses, and 300 for this and that. And she will say for Parthi is 50 rupees, Ammu is 40 rupees because he's a younger brother, and my other brother Sinu is 30 rupees. So it's like that. So the mothers will make a budget. This is all a kind of a fun, you know. Even we really enjoyed all this stuff. I don't understand why these people have to do all this.
And now, the moment we've all been waiting for. Please join me in the countdown. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.